setting. We've also got difficult to move. We've got a lot of people who've been out for 6 years plus. That doesn't mean to say we've been doing nothing with them. It means that a lot of other services will time one of their treatment. And also when they exit treatment, they will be back in for 6 months, so it doesn't affect their target. There are a lot of things. If you look at this contract where it's been levied against the first quarter's data, which we missed by one, which would have taken us in the amber. We don't know what happened in May, which we had 5 exits. In that time, April, May, June, July, we would normally have discussions with our other partners who contribute to that treatment exit. So in other areas, and what the contract really says is it's a treatment systems exit, not just a CWP target. And what will be different in the new contract, whether we're awarded it or not, is that the whole treatment system will be having a target that they have to achieve as a treatment system, not just as independent services. Now what's happened in April, May and June is we cannot have those dialogues with either the commissioners or the other agencies who contribute towards the target, because sometimes what happens is we discharge somebody drug free and another agency will pick them up and put them into structured treatment, which is not actually the exam what we should be in. So they'll discharge them a month later and they'll get the figure rather than us. If you look at the performance action plan template, it says at the bottom that performance can fluctuate month to month. And that's actually what's happened. We missed it by one in the first quarter to go to AMPA. And then June, July and August we've actually exceeded it each month. So the remedial plans we've put in place are actually coming to fruition. So we've got 3 months where we've exceeded plus the target. And we are working with a very difficult to engage population. What will happen in the new tender process is that you'll have a healthier alliance between services in tier 2, tier 3 and tier 4.
Sorry, do you mind if I just add as well that I think we've always struggled with having a target that's just a number. When we've been trying to talk to our commissioners about the ways we're looking at outcomes for individuals, and we know that although we might have people that are on low risk small doses of methadone, we actually know that they are in employment, we know that they're living in very stable accommodation, we know that they have less contact. So I think when we're actually looking at the numbers of people that we're looking after and supporting, we ought to really look at the whole, the whole pathway and a set of different outcomes, not just whether we are in them.
Can I just say that's a really good point in the sense that if you look at this as our dashboard for drugs and alcohol, there's one target we're not hitting, and that is that target. The rest is green, and we missed. Contract reading, we've missed by one person who had to be had dialogue with the other agencies. We may have picked up 2 or 3 people, which would have taken us into AMPA. Now, if you look over the last 6 months, so if you look at the second quarter, which you haven't got the data for yet, you've actually exceeded the target. So the contract reading, I think, is probably premature.
Thank you to my colleagues for explaining the detail of the target, but I think it illustrates, our rationale about going out to retain, because this is a really complicated, complex picture, and the need to make sure that all parts of the system are working well together and joined up is very much a rationale behind our decision to go out to retain.
The next couple are adoption, so this is 35 and 36 on the part of the
people. So 35 talks about 5 children being adopted, whereas in fact there have been 7 children adopted between the 1st of April and the 31st of July. Of those 7 children adopted, the criteria for this is from the time the decision is made that a child should be placed with adoption to the time the child is actually adopted, that should be within 12 months. So a child is not left waiting for too long. Of the 7 children, only 2 of the 7 were adopted within that 12-month time span. And the reason given for that is that of the 7 children, the 2 sets of siblings, 2 pairs, they can have 4 children. The plan was for those siblings to be adopted together, and sadly, the circumstances, because we could not find adopters for those 2 sets of 2, and so they were adopted separately. When that happened, there was absolutely minute and very careful scrutiny. Looked after children have reviews by independent reviewing officers, and the decision to split siblings is balanced against could the children be fostered on a long-term basis, or do they absolutely need permanence through adoption separately? So it's a very careful, hard decision that has to be made. But in this instance, that's caused a significant delay. Second, adoption performance indicator, which is 36, is again looking at those 7 children who've been adopted since the 1st of April this year to the end of July, and looking at time scale to take them to being adopted from beginning to end. So it's not only the decision being made to adopt, to the adoption taking place, from the actual point they come into the care of the looked after into the care of the local authority. And only 1 of those 7 children was adopted within the government's recommended time scale. And the reasons I gave for the delay in the first instance, the 12 months, will apply and will have caused some of the delay in the being looked after to being adopted. This target, both targets, are monitored really tightly externally by the government. If you were to ask Edward Timpson what his top priority is, it is adoption. And he's a minister who comes from a family of adopted and foster children, so it's an absolute priority for him. We have got, actually, within the department, better tracking systems. And certainly, we need to, I would suggest, regardless of whether it's ready or not in the next meeting, provide an update of those children we anticipate will be adopted this year and what the time scales look like for the children projecting forward for the remainder of the year. It is a target we need to improve, and we are tracking children because we have at any time about 60 or 70 children with a very clear adoption plan. So it's a cohort of children we can track individually to monitor time scales. But we have not achieved the time scale at all for this cohort of 7. Of between
30 or 45 or so, and the older idea of a couple of perhaps can't have children themselves. So we're trying to say you can be a single person, you can be a same-sex couple, you can be an older single person or couple. There's no age limit, certainly you have to be over 18, certainly. But there are some we know of younger people in their mid to late 20s who successfully adopted a slightly older child, an individual child. So we are trying to recruit as more adopters, and we do work on a regional, with a regional consortium. So there is a database. Profile and submit our adopters and our children to a regional database, or Adoption 22, to look at how we can secure matches for children across the region. And the amount we pay if we place the children to another authority has been equalised, so we all pay the same amount to try and make it easier. The sole quest is to get that child matched. Guidance from the government and guidance that, well, it's more than guidance, it's the law, the Children and Families Act 2014, places great emphasis on timeliness of adoption and removes some of the barriers or the thinking that may have been around previously, that people would delay for a long time to make sure that the child was matched with a couple or a single person from exactly the same cultural heritage as the child. So getting a good loving home is the priority. And if you can get a good cultural match, good, but you shouldn't wait too long to secure that. So we're doing all that we can, but we don't have an abundance of adopters so we can have a doctor for every child instantly that comes through. Just constantly need to try and secure more adopters. We work with our existing kind of workforce at the time when people are looking at EBR. We're constantly talking about the changing profile of the doctors. So a good number of people coming forward now do have children at home and do it for more altruistic purposes rather than a way of having their own family or completing.
Yeah, another question is, of the older children who are in care and waiting to be placed, do you know how much consultation is done with those children and young people themselves to find out what they want, what they're looking for in a parent, what they're looking for in somebody to look after them?
We do an enormous amount of consultation because the cohorts, the group of cohorts out there, it's a small enough group of children, we really get to know them in detail and do what's called life story work so that children understand their family and it's explained to them in a sympathetic way, so it's not. Often children have what you can call magical thinking, that as a 5 or 6 year old they think, because I got the bed, it's my fault that my mum doesn't want me anymore. It's a very concrete thinking, so it's really important to explain to children their background in a balanced and sympathetic way, because it's very, very rare that it's a parent who, when they have a child or a partner of the mother, who doesn't actually want to bring up that child, and the people through positive circumstances really struggle. A few years ago, I remember we had a little girl, a 7-year-old, who we desperately tried to place with the doctors, and she was matched, and it failed, it didn't work. That happens very rarely in the world. Just want to match children. You spend a long time and do get a good match. But this little girl, lots of people were saying she's 7, she's too old, we'll never find a family for her. And it was the child herself who said to the adoption worker, you know, come on, there must be a mother in Wallasey. And
we found a mother.
I'm not quite sure it was Wallasey. But she's in, and that's a few years ago, and she's permanently matched, adopted, and that's going well. So we do talk to children, and there isn't an upper age limit on when a child can be adopted, although it gets more tricky the older they get.
Just a final question on that. So you talked about the new marketing campaign, and it would be good to, you know, I know there's a lot of organisations use sort of cartoons and sort of little animations now when they aren't able to use, obviously for all the reasons they're not able to actually use, have the children themselves speak, but you can have their voices, you know, their voices done by actors. I'm just going to look into in terms of, you know, getting the voices of the children saying what that 7-year-old said, come on, there must be one out there or someone out there who wants me. I mean, that could be very powerful, just, you know, things like that.
Certainly some of the adopters have got talking books about themselves that that's quite new. So when they have been introduced to a child and the book's being shared with them, the book actually talks to the child so they get a sense of the sound of what these strange people are like before they first meet them. So it's yeah, doing that the other way, with cartoons and animations.
You mentioned a number of measures then that you put into place to make sure this indicator improves. In terms of time frames, when would you hope to see that improvement?
We certainly hope it will be in the right direction by the next quarter, by the time we
we've read last time, we expected to be on with this time, and then the impact of the Cheshire Judgment has an adverse effect. And again, those regional trends, we're not really sure what the reasons for those. Once we begin to understand that, we certainly hope that we'll be in not green, it should be in for a while. Next question. Nationally, which breaks down the model for oral surgery into three tiers. So you have level one work, which is fairly straightforward extractions, which we would expect our high street dentists to be able to undertake for us. The other end of the spectrum, we've got level three work, which is really either quite complex oral surgery work, which might require the skills of a consultant surgeon who's trained not just as an oral surgeon, but as a maxillofacial surgeon. Or it might be it's oral surgery work that's on a patient with quite complex needs, like they've got a medical condition, which means that they really are better treated in a hospital environment. And then in the middle, you've got a sort of middle tier, this tier two, which is straightforward oral surgery procedure. So it might be something like a straightforward wisdom tooth removal or a buried root. And that type of work has been shown elsewhere, particularly in Greater Manchester, for example, we've done a lot of work on this. This can be carried out in a primary care setting. And indeed, across Cheshire, Wirral and Warrington, we've got a number of providers who are already providing that service. But the work that we've done has actually shown that there's probably more of that type of work currently going into our hospitals, which could be done in a primary care setting. And that will give us an opportunity to actually work on reducing waiting lists and provide a quicker turnaround and provide care nearer to patients' homes. So the paper you've got in front of you talks about the recommissioning services for primary care-based oral surgery, which is going to be built just in its very early stages at the moment. These new services, we've currently got some providers in place and their contracts run through to the beginning of July next year. And so we're on a sort of a fairly long sort of run into this. A lot of work to do with our current providers and getting the hospital oral surgeons and the primary care based oral surgeons working together effectively on this. So we're just bringing this to the committee tonight to present to you a sort of slightly redesigned oral surgery service, which will obviously include Wirral, which will allow us to bring some of the services out of the hospital. We're conscious that we'll just be taking a proportion out, because what we don't want to do is to sort of extend
questions on that before I move on to the other one. I think we've got a question.
Thank you very much. I've done before, so I'm very warning that my question, but you've answered two thirds of it, so thank you very much for that. The only thing I wanted to ask then, that we didn't cover, is on page 21 it says, ensure that the waiting time of patients requiring all the surgeries are kept to a minimum. What sort of waiting time for patients requiring urgent treatment?
Right. Well, for non-urgent treatment, we're putting a standard in our service specification that we would expect them not to wait longer than 4 weeks. Obviously, for somebody who's really got a more urgent need for oral surgery, they've either got a wisdom tooth that's really been playing up and causing them a lot of distress, I think we will be, again, working to set some targets with the providers around really sort of turning those around and responding to those cases more quickly. I think that's sort of something we probably need to be slightly more explicit in the service specification going forward.
Just a final one. When you say that, you know, people bidding for the services, is this open dental practices that might feel they can handle certain level 2?
The level 2 work is typically, we have a number of people who've actually done specialist training in oral surgery who've chosen to work in a primary